Yeah.
It's going?
Yeah, it's going good.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the lecture. Yep. We are going to be covering those terms. You got them?
Yeah, sure.
Good. The World Wide Web. I'm going to become famous.
All right. So, like I said, we're recording for all my odd classes. Not that you're odd individuals, but
yeah, no, they are.
Oh, we are
for sure. Let's get moving. All right. Let's see here. Today, we've already knocked out everything here with 13. We will finish up this standard here in terms of the competition for the West with American Indians and government policy towards American Indians. We saw a little bit of that the other day when we talked about, what was our term? Helen Jackson's book, Dawes of Verity. Okay, so we'll pick back up with that, and we'll start to get into some other issues down there. That stuff, well, we'll hit all that stuff a little bit later on. Okay, we talked about Hayes. Remember, Hayes is going to bring in some reform in terms of civil service. That was that executive order of 77. It would later become law under what act?
Pendleton.
Good. All right, under Pendleton. Through the 1880s, we've got issues with Chinese immigration. Eventually, we're going to end up doing what? Yeah, prohibiting with that Chinese Exclusion Act. All right, good. So that'll take us through all that fun stuff. Talked about Garfield. Why does Garfield die? Crossed the political boss. All right. So Gateau took him out. That brought Chester Arthur in. Chester Arthur, you know, just another one of those Gilded Age presidents. Very, very weak. Who's got the power? There you go. The political bosses and the big businesses. We talked about the rise of trust and monopolies. We talked about Standard Oil. Who's the daddy of Standard Oil? Rockefeller, and who, obviously, who is Carnegie Steel?
Carnegie.
Yep. We talked about sharecropping and the New South. Who coined the term New South?
Henry Grady.
There you go, Grady. In the South, in what industries are we industrializing?
Agriculture,
specifically what? Textiles and
cigarettes.
Mm-hmm. Cigarettes. Yep. Other than that, is life much different in the New South?
No, not really.
A lot of people are sharecropping, and we talked about what's going on with this. If you can't see this stuff, go on ITSL. It's all there for you. So, talked about that. We talked about Jim Crow. Who was Jim Crow?
A fictional character.
Yeah, fictional character. What's the symbolism that's attached to Jim Crow, though?
Bumbling buffoon.
Yeah, and so we create these Jim Crow laws. We've got legalized segregation. What are we doing with this? What's the power of symbols?
Makes everyone believe that that's the whole.
Yeah, we use symbols to create meaning, okay? And this is going to be the new status quo, at least until we get to right around 1957. Talked about the 84 campaign. That was Cleveland versus Blaine. Ma, where's my paw on the controversial wire from the state of Maine? Who wins this thing?
Cleveland.
Remember, what state is extremely important in this?
New York.
Okay. Says there, Cleveland's rise is meteoric. Why? Good. First Democrat since before the Civil War. Okay, we talked about his issues. We talked labor unions. Who's this guy? Yeah, little Sammy G, Samuel Gompers. Gompers is going to create what labor union? Yeah, the American Federation of Labor. And what three things do labor unions fight for? Pay, hours, working conditions. Good. Is the AFL the first?
No.
No. But it is going to be one of the what? The largest. All right. And I want to say that in the 1880s, they covered something 18 to 20% of all workers. So they're extremely large. Okay. We talked about GAR. Who is GAR?
Grand Army of the Republic.
And what do they want?
Army pensions.
Yeah. Pensions for veterans. Is Cleveland going to be sympathetic to vet issues?
No.
Why not?
He hired a substitute.
There you go. He bought a sub in the war. Okay. And we'll see how that's going to come back and bite him in a little bit. Talked about the Interstate Commerce Act regulating railroads. What is this Interstate Commerce Act there to ensure? Yeah, reasonable, equitable rates. Okay. Why could the railroad industries charge whatever they wanted?
It's monopolized.
Good. And what's the function of a monopoly?
Eliminate competition.
There you go. Eliminate competition. Good. Now, we talked about that with reform. Are we going to have a Gilded Age president that's strong enough to enforce this stuff? No. Who do we have to wait for?
Roosevelt.
Yeah, Teddy. Okay. Dawes, severalty, I say it's Indian assimilation. What is the actual nuts and bolts of Dawes' severalty?
Divide the lands of the tribe and give them to the people.
Yep. How long are we going to hold this land in trust for? 25
years.
What's the point of holding this land in trust?
Strip it down.
Yeah, you know, we can strip it of mineral resources and then get it back, okay? We are really trying to do what with the Indians? Yeah, assimilate them, okay? So, that pulls us into 1888, okay? The election 1888, June, Democrats are going to get together in St. Louis. Democrats feel good. They feel really, really good. They've got the first incumbent in the White House since before the Civil War. Cleveland is going to get renominated by acclamation. He gets paired up with a former senator from Ohio, a guy named Thurman. Platform for Cleveland and Democrats. Obviously, they have to applaud Cleveland and what he's done over the past 4 years. They're in favor now of a low tariff. They want tax reform. And they want Irish home policy, okay? In terms of foreign policy, they're pushing for what they're calling the Irish home policy. You guys need to pick that up in your reading, and you'll be able to make a lot of connections back to world history. June, Republicans, they're going to get together in Chicago. The factions between the stalwarts and the half-breeds aren't as prevalent, and that's largely because our boy Roscoe Conkling, he's dead. Okay, Roscoe Conkling, he's dead, which means who is kind of the de facto political boss at this point? Me too, Platt. Okay, Tom Platt. Good. Candidates, they've got Blaine from Maine, they've got Sherman out of Ohio, he's in the Senate. On the first ballot, 14 different people get votes, okay? What we're going to see is Harrison, all right? Ben Harrison is going to start climbing the ladder with the more and more votes that go down. Harrison's from Indiana. He's a former Civil War general and currently is in the Senate, okay? Tom Platt, who is that? Yeah, me too. Me too. He's got a little henchman now. His name is, I didn't put it up there, but that's fine. His name is Matthew Quay. They believe they can control Harrison. Okay? And so the political machine is going to be backing Harrison in this election. Harrison gets the nod. He gets paired up with a guy in New York who's in the House, Morton. And their platform calls for a high tariff, civil service reform, reduction in taxes, and Harrison's a military guy, so he wants to help out who? The vets. Okay. In the campaign, Harrison's going to make one front porch campaign, meaning he's going to go out on the porch and give a speech, and all the reporters are going to come to him. The tariff, by far, was the most important issue. Does that surprise anybody? What's the only divisive issue throughout this Gilded Age? The tariff. Republicans are going to use scare tactics. We're going to really see scare tactics being used effectively for the first time in this election. They're trying to appeal to the working man. And they're saying if the tariff is not raised, imports will soar. If imports soar, what happens to the working man? Manufacturing goes down, which means the working man loses his job. Okay? Cleveland in this election is going to lose New York, largely because of Me Too Platt. Okay? We take a look at the election. It looks a lot like the last one, except for New York. A 36-point swing the other way. Is this a different election? Oh, yeah. Okay. So, who's our president? Yeah. Big Bad Ben. There he is. Told you, you gotta have great facial hair. Ben. Ben comes in. Ben Harrison. I want to say he's like nephew or grandson of Ha Ha. He is related to Ha Ha Harrison. You think he's going to give a really long speech? Nah, not at all. We can see his issues. He was known as the soldier senator, so is he going to give love to the vets?
Yep.
Absolutely. We're going to continue to try to regulate monopolies. This is the Gilded Age, though. Are we going to have a president that's strong enough to enforce it? No. But we are setting the stage there. We got to talk tariff, currency, farm issues, and Native Americans. Okay. Vets benefits. Harrison is going to put this guy James Tanner in as the Commissioner of Veterans Affairs. Okay, Veterans Affairs is in the Department of the Interior. Tanner was a Civil War vet who had lost both his legs in the war. Okay, and as soon as Tanner is announced as Commissioner of Veterans Affairs, he comes out and announces that he is going to get as much money as he could for veterans. In 1890, we get the Dependent and Disability Pension Act. Okay? This is going to provide a pension for veterans who served at least 90 days. Alright? You had to serve at least 90 days. And be unable to perform manual labor, which means what? Yeah, you can't work. You probably lost a leg, an arm, or your motor functions. All right. This Dependent and Disability Pension Act would also give pensions for minors and dependents of disabled or dead veterans. All right. Remember in the last one, the one that Cleveland vetoed. It would give the needy parents as well. This is covering them as well. 1895, 5 years after this thing has been passed, yearly appropriations for veterans were somewhere at $135 million a year. Okay, in the first 10 years of this Dependent and Disability Pension Act, the government spent over $1 billion. Sometimes you just have to give them shout outs. Hi, everybody. Like me on Facebook. Yeah, that little box down there, put a comment. Make it okay for school. I want to be trending by the end of the day. It's your job. Are you serious? I don't even know if they can see me. I probably look like Slim Man with the shadow. All right. Now, Harrison. Harrison's going to do a lot for the vets. He doesn't really have a very good relationship with Congress, though. Okay, he's not going to have a good relationship with Congress, and so it's going to be hit or miss whether or not he's going to be able to fulfill all the things that were in his platform. All right. Let's see. Regulating the monopolies. Okay, got to regulate monopolies here. 1890. We're going to get this Sherman Antitrust Act. Okay. A lot of historians will mark this Sherman Antitrust Act as the beginning of the Progressive Era. Remember, the Gilded Age, it's all covered in gold, but it's nasty and corrupt on the inside. The Progressive Era is an attempt to solve the problems that existed in the Gilded Age. I'm not so quick to say this is the beginning of the Progressive Era, because do we have a president who can enforce stuff like this? Not yet, okay? But here we go, Sherman Antitrust Act. Really was an attempt to regulate monopolies. Sherman Antitrust Act prohibited the three C's: contracts, combinations, and conspiracy in restraint of trade. Again, the Sherman Antitrust Act prohibited contracts, combinations, or conspiracy in restraint of trade. What are we directly going after here? What serves to eliminate competition? There you go, monopolies. Okay. Now, we put it in the books, it passes, but again, we're going to have to wait till Teddy and Taft before this actually gets used, because it's the president's duty to move against these trusts and monopolies. Okay? So, take a look at these pictures here, because I guarantee you'll see them again in the future. In this one right here, what are we looking at? Bunch of big fat men. Who are those fat men supposed to represent? Who can read what it says on their belly? Trust. Yeah, we've got the Steel Beam Trust. That would probably represent who? Carnegie. We got the Copper Trust. We've got Standard Oil. Who does that represent? Rockefeller. And then it gets a little weird through here. Who's this supposed to represent? Government. Yeah, Congress. Remember, who's powerful in this time period? Big business. All right, they are overseeing Congress, making sure that Congress does things that they want. All right. Now, does this Sherman Antitrust Act have the ability to deflate these guys a bit? What are we seeing on the picture to the right? What does the boxing piece of paper say? And who are they going after? Yeah, these robber barons, these barons of industry. Okay? Now, remember, Sherman Antitrust Act prevents or prohibits what?
Contracts.
In restraint of trade. Who is going to be the president that has the teeth to actually enforce this stuff? We take a look at the chart down here. When do you think Teddy comes in? 1900. Why do you say that? Yeah. We see here, we see mergers, companies being bought, whether that is going vertical or horizontal in terms of integration. They spike way up right around 1899, and then they hit rock bottom with the introduction of who? Teddy. Okay, this right here is Teddy, and then Taft is down there. All right. So, we've got our Sherman. It's on the books, but we're going to have to wait. Okay. Let's talk tariff. What's the biggest issue?
Tariff.
This McKinley tariff right here, this one, this is dangerous. Okay. Congress is going to increase the tariff. It's a Republican-controlled Congress. Republicans used scare tactics in the last election. They said if we don't raise the tariff, what's going to happen? Yeah, you, the worker, are going to lose your job. Scare tactics, they work. What's one of the best things to control people with? Fear, that's right, I said it first. Actually, I didn't. That was Machiavelli, but same difference. Montesinos, Machiavelli, it's...
Same
guy.
Mason.
I'm not a Mason. where are we at? Oh, yeah, McKinley tariff. It's going to raise the tariff to the highest ever. Okay, highest tariff we've ever had. or the rates will raise the highest ever. What we're doing with this tariff, the industries that we're really pinpointing here, we're placing a tax on all goods and farm products not manufactured in the U.S. This is going to end up increasing consumer prices. Trade is going to slow down. Revenue is going to decrease. Are we getting dangerously low to or dangerously close to our next panic? When was the last time we had one? 73. And we are now in 90. Are we in the red zone? For sure. Great time to start playing with the tariff, right? So, we've got all that stuff taken care of. Last time we talked about the Indians. We talked Dawes severalty. Remind me one more time, what is the point of Dawes? We're trying to assimilate the Indians. We say, hey, we're going to give you private property. We're going to give you citizenship. You must do what? Starts with an A. Yeah, assimilate. Okay. In this, we're also prohibiting them from practicing their cultural rituals. Okay. That's where this guy comes into play. This right here is Sitting Bull. All my odd classes say hi, Sitting Bull.
Hi, Sitting Bull.
You are odd, not an odd class. It's the second period. Braden Smith, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
All right, so there's Sitting Bull. Sitting Bull was really one of the spiritual leaders of the Lakota Sioux. Okay? He is one of the spiritual leaders of the Lakota Sioux. By 1890, we got real issues out west. Okay? Why are we moving Indians off land? Say what? Yeah, mining. Okay? Mining in the west is sparking industry in the east, and who's really powerful right now? Industry in the east. Okay? Native Americans forced from reservation to reservation. We saw tensions begin to rise. If you've already caught up to 1876, which you should have in your book, you probably read about the Battle of Little Bighorn, where the Lakota Indians took out Custer. You guys remember that? At least you learned it from your Americana folklore, all that warm and fuzzy stuff.
Actually, not PC.
What?
Not a PC battle for the
70s. Okay, or the Night at the Museum. Good grief. Yeah, everything that happened in there, completely factual. Completely factual. I mean, Teddy Roosevelt fell in love with Sacagawea. Now, that they wrote that out of history. I'm glad the movie brought it back in. Dumb, dumb. Alright, so, by 1890, like I said, there's a lot of tensions. Native American resistance and federal authority are really at a boiling point. Okay? Sitting Bull, like I said, Sitting Bull was really the spiritual leader of the Lakota Sioux. He was trying to get people to participate in what was known as the Ghost Dance. Okay? The Ghost Dance was a ritual, and it basically, what it did is they would perform this Ghost Dance and seek the advice of the ancestral spirits. Okay? And once they had that advice, they'd know which path to take, so to speak. Okay? Now, when you are trying to achieve full-blown assimilation, is that acceptable? No. All right? You can't talk to dead people. That's just blasphemy. Okay? Federal authorities had already outlawed the ghost dance, as well as others. They saw them as heathenous and subversive to the cultural norms and values that we're trying to place onto the Lakota, and Sitting Bull doesn't care. Okay, he's still going around from village to village trying to get people to participate in this. Okay, federal authorities knew what he was doing. They came in to arrest him, and Sitting Bull and all of the participants at the ghost dance fled. Federal authorities chased them to Wounded Knee Creek. Okay, chased them down to Wounded Knee Creek. Gunfire broke out, and when it was all said and done, 25 soldiers lay dead, 200 Lakota men lay dead. Okay? For all intents and purposes, this is the last stand for the Native Americans. After this, assimilation is going to creep in at a much more rapid pace. Reservations would be broken up into allotments. Those reservations, the allotments were as follows: 160 acres for farming, 70 for adults, 40 for children, and everything that was left over was sold to Western settlers. Okay. Again, is it right? Is it fair? No, but that is the case study of the Native American. Okay. So, why are we doing this? What's the underlying cause?
We want
resources. And we've already talked about farmers out west want what?
Silver.
They want silver. Okay? They want currency that's based off silver. Alright? What we're going to see, also in 1890, right around the same time Sitting Bull and Wounded Knee goes down, is the Sherman Silver Purchase Act. Okay, the Sherman Silver Purchase Act. Sherman Silver Purchase Act is going to require the Treasury to buy 4.5 million ounces of silver a month. Alright, 4.5 million ounces of silver a month. In order to get the money for this, how's the government going to raise this money? No, not taxes yet. We don't tax people outrageously until the 1900s. What do we sell? Bonds. Good. Government's going to sell bonds. And when they sell bonds, they say when you redeem your bond, you can either get gold or silver. If I tell you, hey, you can, if you buy this bond today, in 10 years, you can redeem it for gold or silver, what are you going to redeem it for?
Gold.
Yeah, you're going to buy gold. All right? Or you're going to want gold. What's that going to do to our gold reserves? Deplete the gold reserves. Are we dangerously close to a panic?
Yeah.
Is this a good idea? No. Are we setting ourselves up for success with this McKinley tariff and the regulations surrounding this Sherman Silver Purchase Act?
No.
Nah.
All right. Good. So, we've got issues, but remember, all this silver stuff is being pushed by who?
Farmers.
And as we talked about the other day, the Department of Agriculture is now in the what? Is now in the cabinet, which means they've got a voice inside the head of the president. Farmers' issues are becoming more and more relevant. All right, farmers want more from both Republicans and Democrats. Are they necessarily going to get it? No. So in 1891, they're going to create the Populist Party. Okay, they're going to create the Populist Party. Populist Party has issues. There's little funding. There's weak representation. They do have some real charismatic leaders. You got Tom Watson out of Georgia. Tom Watson was a former Democrat. He was elected in 1890 as a Democrat into the House. He switched party affiliation to the Populist Party. Is that a good thing to do? Nope. And he would be defeated in 1892. All right. Probably one of the most successful populist candidates is Pitchfork Ben. Okay? Ben Tillman. He was out of South Carolina. Same as Watson, former Democrat. 1890, he was elected as governor of South Carolina. Changed affiliations in the mid-1890s. He moved into the Senate, and he constantly struggled to aim the farm focus at Democrats. Why is Pitchfork Ben trying to get Democrats, specifically Democrats, to buy into farmers' issues? Where are the Democrats? And what is the southern economy based off of? Agriculture. It makes sense. Is it necessarily something that people are interested in right now? No. What's the function of a third party?
Introduce
new ideas. And so it's going to take a little bit of time for those new ideas to marinate. What's odd about the pictures that I selected?
The Wizard of Oz.
The Wizard of Oz. Why did I pick the Wizard of Oz? You guys know what a parable is? What's a parable? Yep, a made-up story to explain something. Typically has what involved? Not. Yeah, sure. All right. The Wizard of Oz is a parable on populism. Okay? Did you guys know that?
No. Sure.
When Baum, when Baum wrote this, it was written as a parable on populism. Okay? For example, all right. We got Dorothy. She's the main character, right?
Mm-hmm.
What does she wear?
Red shoes.
That's not true. The original script, silver shoes. They changed it to ruby slippers because at this point we're starting to play with Technicolor on moving pictures, and that red popped better off the screen than a pair of silver slippers. Now, what does Dorothy follow?
Yellow
brick road represents what?
Gold.
Her shoes represent silver. Silver walking on the gold path. Where does the yellow brick road take you?
Emerald City.
Emerald City represents?
Green.
Washington, D.C. All right. When Dorothy makes it to
Washington, D.C.
No. Let's even slide back. When Dorothy makes it to the Land of Oz, her house lands on what? The Wicked Witch of the
West.
East. Come on, man. You need to brush up on your parables. Okay? Yeah. Wicked Witch of the East represents the Eastern industrialists and the bankers. Who did the Eastern industrialists and bankers control? The small people. The small people. All the workers. What's it like working in industry in the East? It's terrible. You're almost a slave. Like who? The Munchkins. All right. The Scarecrow is the wise but naive farmer. What did the Scarecrow want?
A brain.
The Tin Man.
One
of the heart. He's the dehumanized industrial worker. Cowardly Lion. He wanted courage. It's William Jennings Bryan. We'll hit William Jennings Bryan a little bit later on. It goes on and on. Toto, the dog. Toto, short for teetotaling prohibitionists. Oh yeah, we're gonna see prohibition. We're gonna see anti-imperialism, all trying to jump on the train of this populist party. Okay, all of them trying to get in. Sometimes it detracts. All right. When Dorothy falls asleep, she falls asleep because she goes through what? Poppy fields. Poppy seeds are used to make opium. What's going on in Europe? Yeah. All right. You know, and that nearly detracted the populist party. You've got, I mean, it goes on and on and on. It's not a conspiracy. Bomb's just smarter than you. If you're interested in reading more, I've got it right here. Just ask for it.
Was this not written by a guy in the north, though?
Bomb?
Yeah. Because if you go to Oneida, like, they've got the yellow brick road just across the thing that says Wizard of Oz.
I wouldn't be surprised. I don't know necessarily where Bong was from.
Yeah.
If you know, put it down there in the comments. I see people do that in the comments. Now I get to do it.
Are you gonna edit your video so you can just have like little boxes?
Click there? Right?
No, we're putting this right on the video. Alright. So let's keep moving. Like I said, if you guys are interested.
There it is. Look at that. Boom. Rise and fall of the wonderful Wizard of Oz. It's all right there. And you can come and you can look through everything that I just talked about.
Man.
Imagine
just some I'm a technology guru. Watch out. I'm going to be trending, man. I'm going to take, what's that guy's name that does like the crash course?
John Gray.
I'm coming for your job. He's watching this right now.
I'm sure. Yeah, live stream.
He's scared. He's scared.
We need to forward this to John.
So let's not go there yet. Alright. That takes us right to the end. Is Ben Harrison looking good for re-election?
No.
Okay. No. He's not. And so we will. We'll get somebody new elected in 1892. Populists are coming for you. If you want to see more, gotta watch my next video.
Subscribe. Like, subscribe, comment.
Subscribe, favorite.
Watch the like, video. Subscribe, comment.